She's an alumni of our department of Presidency University, erstwhile the Presidency College, and later on she did her master's from JNU. After that, she finished her PhD from London School of Economics, and before joining King's College, she also did her postdoctoral research work from University of Warwick, and later on she worked in University of Sussex as the lecturer. Her primary research area of interest is on development economics, with special focus on effectiveness of public service delivery in developing countries, and also psychological constraints in perpetuating poverty. She has published widely in various renowned journals like Economic Journal, the Journal of Development Economics, Oxford Review of Economic Policy, and she also writes quite thoroughly on various English dailies like The Hindu, The Deccan Herald, and so on and so forth. So without further ado, so Dr. Shaunsheri Roy, welcome to our department, your alma mater, and please start your presentation.
Thank you, Shashati. Thank you for those really kind words. And thank you very much for having me and inviting me to share my research with you. Shashati, I just wanted to check how we should take questions. I'm happy to take questions, clarificatory questions while I'm presenting. So if there are any hands up, if you can just moderate and just interrupt me, or otherwise we can
keep all the questions till the end. Okay. Whatever is comfortable for you, I think it will be hands up. They can directly ask you a question, and if there is a network issue, they can write it down. I will definitely moderate it.
Sure. Thank you very much. So much. Okay. So I'll share my screen. Can everyone see?
Not yet. It will be starting. Not yet visible. Hopefully, it will be starting.
It's visible.
It's visible.
It's visible.
Yeah, you can see? Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks very much. Okay. So, so today's talk is to be on some recent work that I've been doing with a couple of my colleagues, Farzana Afridi at ISI Delhi and Amrita Dhillon, who's my colleague at King's. And this work is looking at something that is touching our lives very deeply on all dimensions, the COVID-19 pandemic. And we are going to basically focus on understanding the implications of COVID-19, the crisis of COVID-19 on livelihood and mental health in urban India. So as all of us are painfully aware, India has been one of the worst hit countries in the pandemic. So I just compiled some data for the purpose of today's lecture from Our World in Data, this fantastic website that has been keeping tab on sort of the pandemic as it has progressed. So here on your screens, you can see the daily confirmed COVID cases for India, which is this blue line, as juxtaposed against some of the other countries that have also been badly hit by the pandemic. So some advanced nations like the US, UK, but, and also some other emerging economies like Brazil and Mexico. So as you can see, this is kind of tracking the entire lifetime of the pandemic. And you can see this big spike, which is essentially picking up the devastating second wave that India experienced. And obviously there is the earlier, in comparison, smaller wave, which was the first wave. And then you can also see this big spike for the UK, for the US, and this is the US. And then you can also see US is going back up again a little over the last, few months. This data is pretty recent, up until a couple of weeks ago. So while for India, we can see that the numbers have steadily been declining and pretty much coming down quite a lot, again, although I've been hearing for the last couple of days a small uptick. So this is kind of the general picture that we are getting of the pandemic for these countries over the last year and a half. But it is undeniable that India has been one of the worst hit in terms of the pandemic. And if we cast our minds back to How it was during the first wave. So all of us remember that right after the first cases were detected in India, the government imposed one of the most stringent lockdowns among all the countries in March 2020 in order to tackle the spread of the virus. And this brought with it huge economic costs, including loss of jobs, loss of earnings, drastic food shortages, as well as the migrant crisis where we saw people had to walk back home because all transport, everything, the entire economy was shut. So we will look at that in terms of specifically the employment losses, but also what was brewing at that time as well, but became more and more clear later was that there was a mental health crisis as well, because people were shut away in their homes. They were not allowed to come out. There were severe restrictions on mobility imposed during the national lockdown. And we are not supposed to live like that. Human beings are social beings. We are meant to meet our friends, our family, interact. So being shut away in our homes with very, very stringent stay-at-home orders meant that there was also a mental health crisis brewing. So we also focus on that in this paper. So just to sort of, you know, set the stage right away very clearly, our study is focusing on the early part of the first wave. So the early part of the national lockdown and also some part of the period when initially unlock one and unlock two were put in place. Okay, so here on the same map, you can see our study, which is picking up this very early part of the crisis. Okay. So we are not looking at what happened, you know, for instance, at the peak of the first wave or at the peak of the second wave, but looking at the time when the mitigating sort of efforts to stop and control the pandemic was mostly having a massive economic impact. So what we do is we provide direct evidence on the impact of the crisis on livelihoods and mental health of urban informal sector workers in India. Now, these constitute some of the most vulnerable sections of the population. They have very few safety nets. They have very little access to social security. But oftentimes in the general media, we don't hear a lot about them. They are more sort of, you know, invisible, let's say, compared to some of the other sections of the population. Hence, you know, we focus on this group of people to understand how the pandemic affected them. And alongside looking at livelihoods and the drastic impact on livelihoods, ours is one of the first study to look at the mental health implications of the pandemic for this vulnerable group of people within a developing country context. So there has been a bit of work that has been done on understanding the impact of the pandemic on people, their perceptions, their mental health, but in the advanced nations. So there's a bit of work that is coming out for the US, for UK, other European countries, but we know much less about how this is unfolding in developing and emerging markets. So our study is trying to sort of make a contribution there. And finally, and most importantly, we also sort of shine a gendered lens on this analysis. So we try and understand how did the COVID-19 crisis in its early part differently affect men and women, and try to sort of understand some of the drivers of that difference as well. So I'll very quickly preview what we find before going on to the details of the paper. So as all of us know, and as we would expect from, you know, what we've seen around us, from anecdotal evidence, from other work, there was a massive negative shock on jobs, massive job losses, massive earnings losses. And we find that this was worse for men in our sample than for women, which is a little bit different from some of the other literature that is emerging from the Indian context. And we sort of tie our slightly different findings for women to the fact that many of our women were self-employed pre-pandemic and therefore may have been able to continue to sort of work from home, which was a luxury not available for many of their other informal sector worker sisters. So this might have sort of set the sample that we study a little bit apart. Secondly, we find very high reported mental stress among all our participants, driven primarily by financial and health worries at that particular early point of uncertainty and so much of chaos. And we find that this this effect is actually worse for women. So we find women reporting greater mental stress compared to their partners. And we will try and understand sort of, you know, what could be driving some of these gender differences. In that vein, we specifically look at two aspects, not to say that these two are the only drivers of these gender differences, but these two sort of, you know, put forward themselves as being some of the key drivers. One is we try and understand the role of pandemic-induced employment losses, especially for men, and what might that have, what impact that might have had on their own mental health, so the mental health of the men as well as of their counterparts, their female counterparts, their wives, and we find that. Pandemic-induced employment losses did heighten stress, and probably more for their wives than compared to themselves. But we find an opposite impact for women's employment, and we're going to dig a little bit deeper into what is going on there when I sort of, you know, come to that towards the later part of the talk. We also looked at the role of social networks, because in that early part of the national lockdown, the stay-at-home orders were very strict. So we all heard and saw stories of people being punished quite severely for stepping out, even if for, you know, essentials and so on. So there was a lot of, you know, stress around that, and a lot of urgency to stay indoors, not interact, not come out. And human beings are social animals, right? So we want to understand what did the loss of the access to social networks do to people's mental health, and did it differently affect men versus women? So what we find is quite an interesting result, which is that women's social networks appear to be aggravating mental stress, whereas men's social networks were having an opposite impact. So again, we're going to delve a little bit deeper into what might be the cause behind these gender differences in the later part of the talk. So were there any questions?
Anyone has any questions? Otherwise, I think you can continue, Shanshu.
Okay, fine. Yeah, just interrupt me whenever there is a question. Okay, so now let me take a step back and take you to the setting of our study. So we are, as I was mentioning earlier, we are studying informal sector worker households in industrial clusters, and our focus is on Delhi. So we focus on 5 out of 11 districts in Delhi, and in these 5 districts, we look at about 10 assembly constituencies. Within each of these constituencies, we randomly sample 10 polling stations, and these make up our primary survey units, our PSUs. And within each PSU, we randomly sample 15 households. Okay, so we have a sort of, you know, a sort of layered sample using random sampling all throughout. And this is where you can see the map of Delhi and where our PSUs are located. So these pink dots are essentially the locations of our primary survey units. As you can see, they are mostly spread out in the northern part of the city. Now, let me tell you a little bit about our data. So we have both pre-pandemic and post-pandemic data for this study. And the pre-pandemic data essentially comes from another study that we had started in 2019, which was looking at a separate question. It was trying to understand the constraints that women face to participate in the labor market. As we all know, women's labor force participation in India is pretty low, and even lower in urban areas. So that project is focused on trying to understand the constraints that women face in participating in the labor market. And for that project, we had run our first baseline in the middle of 2019, in the summer of 2019. So there, that was a sort of regular face-to-face study. This was pre-pandemic times. And we surveyed about just over 1,000 households in that study. And then we were about to go back for our follow-up in the early to middle part of 2020, which is when the pandemic happened. And we were just about to hit the field, so the lockdown was announced. So we quickly had to move from a face-to-face full-blown survey to a much shorter and a phone survey. Okay, and this is the phone survey we conducted during April and May of 2020. So this coincided with the lockdown, the national lockdown that India was experiencing. And we were able to reach back to about 745 of those 1,000 plus baseline households, which was not a bad rate given the very extreme circumstances we were facing at that particular point in time. And for most of this analysis that I will present to you today, this is the sample that we are focusing on. Okay. Now, the main respondent of all the phone survey questions is the husband, okay? So we shortened the questions. We couldn't go on for, let's say, a 50-minute interview because nobody's going to talk to us over 50 minutes on the phone. So it was a much shorter survey, and most of the questions were directed to the husband. They would answer questions relating to their employment status, you know, earnings, and so on and so forth. They also answered questions on their mental health. But for mental health, we also asked the husbands to pass on the phone to their wives. And we asked the wives the mental health question as well. So for employment and earnings data, we have both pre-pandemic and post-pandemic data, right? For mental health, we don't have pre-pandemic data because this was not asked in the baseline, but we have post-pandemic data and we have it separately for both men and women. So it's husband-wife matched data, which really allows us to get a nice peek into how the pandemic was differently affecting mental health for men and women. Okay. Now, you might be thinking that, well, if we are asking the husband to pass on the phone to the wives, were we asking the wives, you know, to maybe move to a more secluded area to give us answers in private? And the short answer is yes, we did request the wives to move to a more secluded place to give us their answers in private so that, you know, we are less likely to be affected by reporting bias. However, in a phone survey, there is no way to completely ensure this. We did request, and we do think that most women would have complied, but there is no guarantee, which does bring back into concern the issues relating to reporting bias, right? However, if, for instance, the family members, including the husband, were indeed present while the women were giving us answers regarding their mental health, we argue that this would probably make the women underreport. So they might actually be feeling greater anxiety, but because everybody is around, they are more likely to sort of, you know, give us a more distilled picture of how they are feeling, in which case our findings are probably picking up the lower bounds and the real effects are probably even larger and the real gender differences are probably even bigger than what we are picking up. That's how we argue to address the concern of reporting bias, but not to diminish the fact that this is a concern, and this is how we go about addressing it. Okay, now let me talk to you about what are our primary outcome variables. So the first outcome variable we focus on is employment or working status. So this is essentially picking up whether or not you're engaged in paid employment at the time of the survey. And we have this for both men and women. Second variable is monthly earnings. This is information we have only for men. We didn't ask this of the women. And the final outcome variable is a sort of index that we constructed using our the bunch of mental health questions we asked. Okay, so we, in particular, we asked five specific questions relating to mental health, are kind of linked. Yes,
there are two questions. You know,
please go ahead,
Nikita. Would you please ask your question and then Zaki? Nikita?
Nikita, you'll have to unmute yourself and ask.
You have to. Sorry.
So, Zakir, would you please first present?
Or if you can type also Nikita. Just let me see if she's there. Yeah, she's still there, but she's muted.
Okay, Zakir, so please.
Okay, I'll ask.
You also have a question.
I mean, it seems to be a very interesting study, but just two clarifications. The mental stress index that the questions that you have asked, how valid are they? Do they correspond to any established protocol?
Yes. Shall I take both your questions and then I?
Yeah,
can
yeah.
Answer.
I think better.
Yeah.
And the second is you said that the males may be underreporting, but I think the females may be underreporting, but I think the males may also be underreporting, because if they have to give the responses in front of their wife, and they might feel that it's not it's not so mature to reveal one's weaknesses.
You're right. I think
third is, sorry, I'm asking too many questions, perhaps.
That's okay. That's
third
okay.
is that, it's a phone survey, right? So I think you had collected the phone in 2019 and then you had used the same phone numbers. So is there a possibility that those who are, who had been thrown out of work, they are the persons who's, sorry, just one second. I have to admit someone. Yeah, sorry. So the persons whom you missed out are the ones who have been very badly hit, and therefore they have given up their mobile, so that there's again some sort of underreporting in your work. If you could just comment on these.
Yeah, yes. I'll go with the, I'll start reverse order. So you're absolutely right that, these were people whose phone numbers we had collected in the baseline, and we were able to reach back to nearly 75% of them. But your concern is absolutely valid that the ones that we didn't manage to reach back to, are they systematically different from the ones that, we did? And while we wouldn't be able to directly answer the question of whether they, were worse hit in terms of the employment shock, when we look at the baseline characteristics of the people who we were not able to reach, exactly, they don't look any different. Okay, so that's kind of the best we can do to address your concern, which is to say that it's not, doesn't appear to be any systematic variation in terms of who we were able to reach and who we were not. In a lot of cases, as you know, what happens, people change their phone numbers, right? And when they change their phone numbers, they've got a new phone, then we are not able to reach back to them. Although what we did do, which is how we did manage to reach probably a slightly larger proportion, is we were also, we also had numbers of their immediate neighbors and so on, right? So if we were not able to directly contact them, we would contact their neighbors so that, they could give us an alternate number, we could go back to them and talk and so on. So there were multiple things that we did, which did ensure that we could reach quite a few more. But in terms of whether we were systematically missing out the poorer sections, it doesn't appear to be so, at least to the extent that it might completely overrule our results. So that's my first response, or rather my response to your third question. About the males underreporting, that's, I think, a very interesting point you raise as well. So essentially, it would depend. I think you probably are, to some extent, reinforcing what I'm saying, is that it's possible that in the presence of the husbands or the wives, whoever is answering the question, they are likely to underreport, right? Now, the question is how much of an underreporting, additional underreporting is going on by gender. That is very difficult to pick out. But if they are both underreporting, then in a sense, it's possible that, the reporting bias that we might be exposed to might not be, systematically different between men and women, in which case the gap still survives. But it's a very tricky one to be able to answer directly, because that's something we cannot really measure in our survey. And I forgot your first question, Zakir.
Whether the mental health questions correspond to any international?
Yes, you're absolutely right. So the first, so what we did, and I was just going to come to that, is that these questions, given the constraints of time that we faced, as I mentioned to you, we shortened the survey. So these questions were some of the most key questions we picked from a similar study that was being done, which was a cross-country study. A bunch of other co-authors were doing this for, you know, about 150 countries. So our questions were very closely matched to these surveys that were being run across many countries. So it was benchmarked to corresponding studies that were being done at that particular point in time to pick up on mental stress, which were related to, let's say, other broader psychological studies that may have been done, but trying to keep it all within the time frame and sort of, you know, within the constraints of the phone survey, while being able to still pick up some nuanced variation and meaningful variation. Okay.
Ashok,
I hope that answers your question.
Shanchari, there is one question.
It's a very clarificatory question, Shanchari. It's related to immense employment status.
Go ahead.
So do all of them work in informal sector? I mean, what does the data reveal?
I'll show you that in a second when I show you the descriptive statistics. But the short answer is no, they don't all work in the informal sector. We do have some women who are in salaried work, but it is very small. And the overall proportion of women who are working is also quite low, within which we have variation between what we call casual work and some of it being self-employment. But I'll come to that in a second when I show you the descriptive statistics. Okay.
Thank you.
Were there any other questions?
Yeah, Shanchari ma'am, if I may ask. Okay,
yes,
so
please.
I had two questions. One you have already answered regarding men underreporting. The second one is this ability to seclude and answer in that, you know, privacy, that might be correlated to the, you know, the how big the house is, right?
How big the house is, yes, of course, yeah.
And if that is correlated to the way they are responding, right? So in a way, this underreporting is not uniform. It's going to depend on these household characteristics. So how do you take that into account in the analysis?
Actually, we could look at that. I don't think we have, but because we have information in our baseline survey about number of rooms and also a sense of, you know, where they are in the socioeconomic ladder. So we have asset indices, we have a bunch of other socioeconomic dimensions that would be correlated to, let's say, space and so on. We could look at variation, sort of heterogeneous treatment effects that utilize this variation. So that will be one way to see whether this would be correlated to, let's say, the availability of physical space, which is then definitely correlated with socioeconomic status, right? So we haven't done that, but thanks for that. We could definitely have a look at that. Were there any other questions, or shall I go on?
I think you go on because I just
Sure. Yeah. And then we can collect a few more and then take them together. Okay. So, going back to and sort of following on what Zakir was mentioning, going back to how we constructed the mental health index. So we had these five questions, which were kind of connected to and sort of, you know, taking from these other standard questionnaires that were being implemented around that particular point in time. Our questions focused on five aspects: financial stress, health stress, nervousness and anxiety, sort of, you know, symptoms of depression and sleep disorders. And all of these, the way they were asked, was specific to the COVID-19 crisis. And participants could respond to these questions on a 5-point scale. So, you know, strongly agree, disagree, and so on and so forth. And then we took their responses to these questions and created binary variables out of it. So for instance, we classified somebody as suffering from nervousness and anxiety if they strongly agreed or agreed with the statement that, yes, I feel very anxious and nervous at this particular point in time. So then they would be classified as getting a 1 in the binary for anxiety and 0 otherwise. And then all these binaries were aggregated into a mental health index, which is between 0 and 1. And then we standardize it by subtracting the mean and dividing by the standard deviation. So this has basically become a standardized z-score, and the interpretation of the coefficients would be in standard deviations. Okay, so just to sort of make it unit-free and simple to interpret when we look at the results. That's how we constructed it, and that is kind of quite standard to what some of the other papers have also done at that particular point in time. Okay, so this is where I go back to looking at some of the descriptive statistics, and I was sort of referring to this table when I was answering one of the earlier questions. So these are household characteristics, and this is pre-COVID, so this is from the baseline, and you can see that this is household characteristics and these are individual characteristics, and you can see that these are mostly single income households. So if you look at women's employment, or the proportion of women who say they are in paid employment, is pretty low, right? So these are single income families, and among the men, they are mostly engaged in casual work, so wage labor, day-to-day work, or they are self-employed. There are significantly fewer of them who are in salaried work. Okay. The other interesting point I want to make here is if you look at the number of years this particular household, these households on average have been in the current location, that they've been here for a while, they've been living in these clusters for a while, but many of them have family back in villages. So you could think of these households as being sort of kind of permanent migrants. So they have moved to these areas for work, but many of them have families back in villages in Uttar Pradesh, in Bihar, in Jharkhand, which also sort of has implications for remittances that they might be sending back home, and what the COVID-19 crisis would have done to that. Okay. So that's pretty much what I had to say here. Okay. Any questions so far? Otherwise, I'll move on directly to talking about the findings.
Titila, could you please ask the question?
Hi. Hello. That so people mentioned about respondents underreporting their state of mental anxiety and all. So I was thinking maybe they will overreport because so these people belong to overwhelmingly on the poorer scale, poorer side of the income spectrum, and if they see people living around them are economic. So they may be in a state of despair, and we know that during April in Delhi, things were not good. So maybe they were panicking uniformly. So, but you have data from the same cluster, neighborhood clusters, right? So maybe from there you can infer something.
In fact,
and also I was going to ask about the migrant status also, but you are saying that these people are kind of well settled in Delhi. So maybe that was not any extra source of anxiety, but maybe what's going on in their ancestral village could be impacting their mental state. But I'm mostly thinking that these people are living primarily in economically homogeneous neighborhoods. And if these are mostly informal sector workers, they were hit in April. Definitely things were not good in Delhi last year. And especially after the riots and all. And so how likely are their mental state to be good? Or
right. No, I agree. I agree with what you're trying to say. I think what you're trying to say is that they might be living among other families, amidst other families who are also going through the same process, which is exactly true. So if you look at when I show you the employment numbers, the employment losses, majority of our sample lost their jobs. But that is not significantly different from the picture that is emerging from other parts of the country and also other parts of Delhi. So I mean, it is very hard to probably tease out how much this could be contagion and how much this could be sort of, you know, individual experiences. We will try to get to this, especially the contagion story, towards the end of the talk when I talk about social networks. So, you know, we will come back to this point. But also, I wanted to point out that all our analysis is clustered at the neighborhood level. So kind of at the polling station level, which would potentially be a sizable group of households. So you know, some of this would be essentially looking at within the using, or you're using the within neighborhood effect, which means that we would still be sort of picking up something that might be endemic in terms of what is happening to people's mental health. But coming back to the contagion point, let me revisit this question when I show you the social network results. And, you know, there is some interesting gender difference there. And maybe we can have a conversation about how to sort of better interpret what we are finding, if that's okay with you. Okay.
I don't think there is any more questions, Shanchari.
Okay. Let me then move on to the sort of main results. So I'll start with the impact on men's employment. Shashita, I just wanted to double check, how much more time do I have? I've completely lost track of time. How much more time do I have?
You can take another 15, 20 minutes, yeah.
Okay, fine. I think I'll be done by then. Okay. So let me show you the headline results for men's employment. Essentially, this is the picture that will sort of, you know, give you a sense of the extent of the shock. So the green bars are the working status for so the percentage of people employed as far as men are concerned pre-COVID. This is pre-COVID and this is post-COVID. And the blue bars are for women. And as you can see, there is this massive shock. There is this massive negative shock in terms of employment status post-COVID relative to the baseline. And in terms of sort of, you know, the extent, the magnitude, this is about 84% of men reporting completely being unable to work over the survey period in our sample. Okay. We did not find a significant impact for women's reported employment. So this is what is being picked up by these blue bars. And while this is a precise zero, what this is potentially picking up is what I was referring to earlier when I was previewing my results, that there is a non-trivial proportion of women who are employed, who are self-employed in our sample, who were self-employed earlier and were exposed to self-employment opportunities. So just to give you a background, a lot of these industrial clusters are close to factories. So for instance, I'll give you an example of one of the field visits that I made, where we were talking to women living in this cluster next to a shoe factory, okay, a leather factory. And many of these women are engaged at in working on parts of, let's say, the shoe, okay? So parts of the production chain has been subcontracted out to these women who are working from home, maybe fixing the sole or maybe fixing the strap and so on. And they were doing them. These field visits happened pre-pandemic. So they were sort of, you know, they had access to these opportunities and they were able to engage in this kind of, you know, work from home. So the fact that many of these women had this kind of option and were engaged in this kind of work probably meant that post-pandemic, when everything was still shut, parts of this the work were probably still being undertaken by some of these women from home, which is kind of a luxury not many women in this particular income strata would have access to. So if you think about domestic workers, apartment houses or most of their employers were not allowing them to come to work, right? So they had to stay at home, they lost their livelihoods. Whereas in our sample, probably a lot of these women had access to these self-employment opportunities and probably continued to be able to engage with that even post-pandemic, at least in those early periods, which is probably what is explaining the fact that we don't see an impact on women's employment, which is different from, let's say, some of the other studies that are emerging around sort of Delhi or other parts of the country. So if you think about Sonal Desai's work, or if you look at Ashwini Deshpande's work, you see that there they find that women also have a negative, they also experience a negative shock in terms of their employment status, conditional on their baseline employment, probably larger than men, and probably slower to come back and recover, whereas probably the specificities of the sample that we are looking at as far as women's employment is concerned is giving us a slightly different picture. We also just wanted to point out that as far as the men were concerned, the worst hit were the wage and casual workers. So everybody, all the men were hit. So 84% of men report having lost their work, but it was sort of, you know, concentrated more for the informal sector workers, including the daily wage workers and the casual workers. Salaried workers were also affected, but probably marginally less so. So this is basically what you have, what you're being shown here, but the effects are still quite large across the board. And finally, to look at men's earnings, again, consistent with what we just saw as far as employment losses is concerned, earnings losses were also massive. So 89% reduction in men's earnings is what we estimate compared to the baseline, compared to the pre-pandemic levels. Whether you look at unconditional or you look at conditional employment, you see this massive drop in terms of monthly earnings that are reported by men. Unfortunately, as I was mentioning, we don't have parallel data for women's earnings, so we are unable to look at that. But overall, what is being what is emerging, the picture that is emerging, is one of massive economic consequences, negative economic consequences that these families were grappling with, which is obviously not very different from the situation for many other households across across the country, especially in informal sector. But it is sort of, you know, important for us to be able to put some numbers to understand the intensity of this negative shock.
If I may just interrupt, please. Prithviraj talked about there may be a possible over-reporting of the conditions.
Right, because
I would say that the possibility of over-reporting once the distress would be stronger over here in these economic aspects. I mean, the huge decline that you observe for males.
Yes.
But no decline for females. That seems a bit... I don't know. I mean, because even in the case of the woman, they may be working at home, but they have a derived demand. If the factory closes, then their demand for women's work will also fall. So I think, I mean, there may be a possible reporting bias. I mean, people are expecting in case of distress, they will get relief. So I don't know. I mean, how have you...
Right. If I understand your point correctly, so you're worried about the reporting bias coming in for women?
For men, given the fact, and particularly given the fact that there's no change for women.
Right.
It's very high for males. Too high for males, I would say.
Right. The point that I would like to mention here is that if you remember in the phone survey, we asked the men all the questions, right? So what we are picking up here is actually report the women's employment reported by their husbands. Okay, so if we so it's the same person who is reporting their own employment loss, as well, whatever status, as well as their wives. Okay, so the fact that there is not a lot of difference is probably more likely to be picking up the real effect than a reporting bias effect, if that makes sense, because it's the same person who is reporting their own status as well as that of their partner, right? Now, if we are worried that the husbands would over-report their own employment losses and under-report their wives' losses, we need to have a very nuanced sort of, you know, explanation that potentially probably ties to gender attitudes here to sort of explain that. And I was going to kind of link your point with what we look at in the next part of the presentation, where I will show you the relationship, no causal interpretations here, but sort of the association in the data between pandemic-induced employment losses and mental health, okay? And also the identity of the person whose employment loss is being looked at, okay? So maybe we can sort of come back to this point once I have showed you that result, because we are finding interesting gender differences there. But going back to your point about whether men are over-reporting their employment status or employment losses, I guess we would probably need to think a little bit further about what would be the explanation that ties that with sort of them reporting pretty much, no effect for their wives. Okay, does that make sense?
Yeah, sure. And I think we're taking so much of your time.
No, that's fine. Don't worry about it.
We need to continue a bit more than 10-15. Take your time, please.
That's okay. No, it's good to have the questions, because then otherwise I feel that, you know, we would forget the questions if we only left them till the end. Okay. So let me now, so these are just the tables and they're all there in the paper. So, you know, I'd be happy for you to sort of have a look at them and give me feedback later on more closely. But let me now move to the implications for mental health, okay? So first off, I want to show you just again the descriptives about what was the reported level of mental stress during the pandemic, bearing in mind that we don't have pre-pandemic baseline benchmarks. Okay, so what we have is currently the the mental health that was reported, mental stress rather, that was reported in the phone survey itself, and we observe sort of gender differences there. And there, obviously, there's a bunch of questions that relate to whether these gender differences are endemic, because, you know, there's a lot of literature pre-pandemic as well, which argues that there are gender differences in mental health. So the question is then, are we picking up a gender difference here, or are we picking up the effect of the pandemic? Whatever it is, we have these descriptive results and we are trying to sort of dig deeper into them. So the first sort of set of results that we have for mental health is very high reporting of mental stress due to the pandemic. And this is what you see here. So for example, if you look at financial stress, if you look at health stress, significantly very high number of participants in our survey report suffering from financial and health stress, as well as from anxiety, depression, and sleep disorders. But then you see these gender differences again between the green and the blue bars, and they are more pronounced for anxiety, for nervousness, and partly also related to sleep disorders. Okay. So this is kind of just showing you the estimates for sort of, you know, this graph. So this is just giving you the sense of the exact numbers that we have. And combining all the different aspects, we find that, you know, the level of mental stress overall reported by women is significantly higher than their male counterparts, than their husbands. Okay. That's what we have here. So now I want to look a little bit more into what might be explaining these gender differences. And again, we can then connect back to the earlier question about sort of contagion, about what might be happening with networks, about what might be happening due to the pandemic-induced employment losses, all of these aspects together. And so therefore, we specifically focus on these two dimensions. We will look at the role of pandemic-induced employment losses in explaining some of these gender differences, and also look at the role of social networks. So just to be clear here, this is not a causal analysis in any way, right? Because all we are trying to do here is try to understand how much of the variation in the gender differences of pandemic-induced mental stress that we are observing is being explained by the pandemic-induced employment losses as well as network sizes. Okay, so this has nothing to do with how we would want to understand the causal implication of unemployment on mental health or network size on mental well-being, because as we know, all of these are endogenous, right? So, you know, whether or not I belong to a larger network size is a completely endogenous choice, as is sort of, you know, implications for employment or unemployment and what that means for mental health. So this is just to try and understand the associations and how much of variation we can explain, okay? So first off, we find that men's employment losses played quite an important role in increasing mental stress, both for themselves and their wives, but more for their wives, okay? So here is the main result that I'm trying to sort of imply to here. So if you look at the first column, and if you look at this variable, which is employed post-COVID, so this is picking up the association between continuing to be employed post-COVID for men and their mental stress. Okay, so there is this inverse relationship. So which would therefore mean, if you switch this around, that suffering from unemployment, COVID-induced unemployment, would actually increase mental stress for the husbands, right? But there is a higher impact, it seems, on the wives. Okay, so the negative impact or the negative relationship, I should use the word impact, the negative association is larger for the wives of the people of the men who have lost their jobs. Okay, so there seems to be potentially this internalization of who is supposed to be the breadwinner and who is supposed to be the earning member of the family. And if you look at the socioeconomic setup that we are located in terms of our study, we can see that there might have been scope for this kind of internalization, so that when the men lost their jobs, there is obviously a lot of stress in the household, and that is also being picked up by what the women or their wives are reporting. Okay, so that's what we have here. Now, if we turn the lens to what is going on with the women, okay, so if the women continues to remain employed, right, then that seems to be having a positive association with mental stress. And this in most households is the case where the men have lost their jobs. So it seems to suggest that in households where the men are employed, if the women continue to be engaged in some kind of paid work, right, that seems to be associated with greater mental stress, both for men as well as for the women. Okay, so the employment mental health association goes in opposite directions for men and women. And therefore, we try to sort of, you know, discuss whether there could be a role of internalized gender norms, both on the men's side as well as on the women's side, whereby the loss of employment for men is creating a huge amount of stress for themselves and their partners, whereas in those households where there is some continued work for the women, that itself is having additional increase on stress levels, both for women and their men. Okay. And we find this quite interesting because while we are unable to specifically, put a pin on whether these are being driven specifically by gender norms, what it does seems to suggest is that there is something going on within the household in terms of household dynamics, right? Relating to what happened to employment because of the COVID-19 shock, which is having an aggravating effect on men and women's mental stress. Okay, so this probably speaks to some interesting household dynamics on which we are not able to directly throw evidence, but there is some speculation that we can make on that. Okay, before I move on, I wanted to quickly check if there were any questions. Otherwise, I'll just preview the social network results.
I don't think there.
Clarification. Okay. So there is this, consensus in the literature that male members generally tend to have first hold on the availability of jobs whenever there is dearth of jobs availability, right? Mm-hmm. So why would they not displace their wives and take up their jobs?
Again, it probably the answer to that question would relate to the kind of jobs that we are actually looking at. Again, we don't have data specifically on the kind of jobs that they are doing as far as the phone survey is concerned. But we do know what work they were doing in the baseline. And the kind of work that these women are engaged in, if you think about sort of the self-employed women, these are very specific to the part of the entire production process that they're responsible for. So this is very gendered in a lot of contexts, especially in like these factories that we were looking at. Heavy machinery lifting, so work that correlates with lifting heavy machines or working with heavy machines, those which are concentrated on the shop floor or on the factory floor, are mostly done by men. Whereas the bits of the work that we saw women were to be engaged in mostly from home were the bits that related to, as I was telling you before, sticking the soles or working with the straps and so on. And there was a sense, again, this is very interesting sort of insights that we got from the baseline. There are very strong, opinions about what is a man's work and what is a woman's work. So even if there was an opportunity for maybe doing some of this work from home, it is not entirely clear in the very short run whether that kind of work would be appealing to the men who are now unemployed, right? And there was, if you think about it, at that particular point in time, very early on in the lockdown, not a lot of clarity about when things are going to go back to normal, whether this is going to be in a state of permanence or so on. So, you know, men were probably sitting tight, right? And they were not necessarily particularly keen to take up the kind of work that may have been available. And also, if you think about it, it's not just us who, the individual themselves, who have perceptions or attitudes or opinions about what kind of work they want to do or not. There is also societal perception of what is constituted to be, what is thought to be men's work and what is thought to be women's work. So it's a, I would say it's a complex set of dynamics that would have probably perpetuated whatever patterns we were seeing at that particular point in time in terms of occupational choice. That was a very long answer, but I hope that made some sense.
Absolutely, thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, so now in the next, I think I'm over probably in terms of my time limit, but very quickly, let me tell you a little bit about what we find for the social network story. Okay, so in the sociological literature, we have seen that there are various theories that have been put forward in terms of how to explain the role of social networks in terms of mediating psychological stress, okay? So there is the social buffering role, which is that, you know, I have access to a bunch of friends or, you know, close acquaintances, and they act like my stress buster. So when I have larger number of friends to sort of, you know, help me buffer my stress, then I'm less stressed, okay? So there is this inverse relationship between size, network size, and mental well-being, okay? On the other hand, there is also another theory, which is talking about stress contagion. So the fact that, you know, I have access to many friends in times of stress and in terms of stress that is correlated. So all of us are suffering from the same stress. There could be a stress contagion story, which means that, you know, more number of friends I have to talk to, maybe we end up just stressing each other out. So therefore, that relationship could then be a positive relationship in terms of larger network sizes also having an association with greater stress. So we are able to sort of look a little bit into this because we collected quite a lot of rich data on our individuals, friend and sort of acquaintances networks in the baseline, okay? So we calculate the number of total friends that each participant reports, okay? And we then disaggregate their friends by type of friends, where type essentially sort of implies whether or not these friends are more closer to their home. So home-based friends, so maybe your neighbor, your next door neighbor, or your cousin living across the lane, or, you know, your friends who lives next door, versus work-based friends. Okay, so we try and sort of separate that. And the main result that we find as far as sort of relating network size, so the size of the number of friends you have with reported mental stress, is that networks appear to be increasing or being associated with greater mental stress for women, but not for men. Okay. And this seems to be entirely driven by home-based friends. So if I show you the table, if you just focus on the second and the third column. The first column is just picking up the gender difference in terms of reported mental stress that you also saw in the graph. But if you look at column two, you see that for the men, having a larger social network is actually associated with lower mental stress. But the story is completely the opposite for women. So for women, having access to a larger social network is actually associated with greater mental stress. And this is entirely being driven by their home friends. So work friends do nothing anywhere, okay? But it's for home friends, so friends who are living sort of near you, next door or whatever. This is where we find the association to be the strongest. So then the question is, what is going on? So there could be quite a few stories that explain this. So it could just be that women have larger pre-existing networks, and this is true in our sample. So in our in the descriptive statistics table, I forgot to mention it, but if you noticed there, women on average report having about between 5 and 6 friends, and men report having about 3 to 4. So women do sort of report having slightly larger networks, although more close networks, meaning living very close to them. So could it be that, you know, women are just missing their friends due to social distancing during that early part of lockdown? So I'm not able to meet my friend, I'm not able to go to my friend's house or my acquaintance's house, and that regular sort of social contact is missing from my life, and therefore I'm just getting increasingly stressed. So is it that story? Or is it that actually women's networks do something different compared to men's networks for their mental well-being, and it's more related to greater contagion that they are creating amongst themselves? So to try and start at disentangling these two, not to say that we have the last word for it, but we, in our attempt to disentangle these two stories, what we do is we look at women who own mobile phones in the baseline, right? So you could think that one way to overcome the problem of, you know, not being able to meet your friends but still stay in touch would be to, you know, basically be in touch with them over phone. And if we look therefore at the women who are mobile phone owners in the baseline, then if it is the stress buster story, then these women should therefore be able to overcome their stress, and therefore should not be displaying this kind of a positive correlation, right? And that's what we do here. That's what we do here in column 4. So we look at women who own mobile phones in the baseline, but we find that the positive correlation persists. So we find that even for those women who are able to keep in touch over the phone with their friends, they are still likely to show us positive correlation between having larger network sizes and greater mental stress, which therefore seems to be pointing to more of a stress contagion story, right? That they are potentially stressing each other out. And also remember, everybody is here affected by the same crisis. But it doesn't seem to be affecting the men to that extent, right? In contrast, for men, having access to larger networks seems to be potentially minimizing or at least mediating some of their psychological stress. So that kind of opens up the question, which we are not able to answer in this paper, but hopefully we are sort of planning some follow-up work that will help us delve deeper into this, is what is different about men's and women's networks, especially at the time of crisis, that can have these differential implications for mental well-being, okay? So that's basically what I had here. I will conclude and then take all the remaining questions together, because I don't want to abuse further my time. So today what I have shared with you is a study that tries to understand the implications of the massive COVID-19 shock on livelihoods and mental well-being among a group of urban informal sector workers in Delhi. And we find that there was a huge negative impact on male employment and earnings, but not so much for females. We find huge increases in mental stress, more for women relative to men, but we must be careful here because we are not able to benchmark this with baseline levels. And we also found a couple of interesting results that relate pandemic-induced employment losses for men, having heightened the stress within the family, especially among their wives, and also this gender differential effect in terms of how social networks are mediating psychological stress for men and women in our sample. I'll stop there and happy to take questions.
Thank you, Shanshari. Thank you. You already took a lot of questions and we actually abused your time. Okay, so any further questions from anyone?
I'll stop sharing my screen if that's okay. I can always come back to it, because then I can see you all. Yeah, I can see you all.
We do have a question from Udita, I think. Udita, can you unmute yourself?
Uh, Yes, good evening, ma'am. It was a really nice paper presentation. So one question that was sticking with me when you were talking about social networks is, while you were going ahead and studying social networks, did you all consider taking into account if local leaders or like access to, say, Anganwadi workers and that sort of group kind of help to provide, say, either like a stress buster or like a stress contagion? Because that's a big support network. What our leaders are saying, what women who go to ICDS centers are hearing from the workers there.
Right. No, Udita, we actually didn't specifically look at that. We do have information about, you know, kind of transfers that people received. Especially if you think about those early times of the lockdown, there was huge food shortages, right? So we asked questions about whether you had access to medicine, whether you had access to this kind of transfers, these kinds of support networks. But specifically, we didn't look at their access to, let's say, local leaders or other, you know, governmental support. I'm wondering whether there would be a way to address it, because I think I'll have to think a little bit about that. We do know, obviously, who are the local leaders, because we our PSUs are these election sort of polling stations, and we also know the assembly constituencies and so on. But whether or not people were accessing this kind of resource is something I will have to check.
We do have a question from Prithvi Asta. Yeah.
Hi, Shanchari. So I was thinking this woman having phones and they being more stressed, they're reporting being more stressed, could be correlated with that they're on WhatsApp and sharing like more stressful news, and they're also watching news. And also having phone, maybe they are on an upward trajectory on social mobility, and they are more concerned about the income loss, maybe kids' education. I mean, in Delhi, even though, I mean, kids' education can be financed quite well via, I mean, can be delivered quite well via public education system, but there could be other sources of things which matter for social mobility, which could be clouding their minds.
I think you're absolutely right. And I think these would potentially... Sorry, Prithviraj, you were saying something?
No, I was just saying that it's just my observation here.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think you're absolutely right in the sense that these potentially would be the mechanisms through which a lot of this, contagion is potentially happening, right? I'm not entirely sure if this could be driven fully by social media, because when I mention about mobile ownership, this is also all these button and semi-smartphones as well. So it's not everybody having a smartphone or sort of using social media, but there definitely seems to be a space within which the contagion is exacerbated. Right. And the fact that we find that even if you look at the aggregate effect, right, that is positive, that there is this positive association. And also for the women who are owning the mobile phones. So this seems to be a more widespread effect that we are observing, or a widespread association that we are observing. Definitely there could be socioeconomic angles explaining this, you know, greater stress regarding what is going to happen to kids and so on. But overall, and these would definitely feed into the story I'm telling, which is that, you know, you're stressing yourselves and each other out, probably more than your partners are amongst themselves, right? So I think this would be entirely consistent with the story that I'm trying to say here.
And you do not collect any information regarding, like, whether the husband or the wife, and to what extent they're contributing to the household expenses, how much of the income burden is on each of them.
No, we didn't collect this kind. This is very sensitive to ask, actually.
Yes, of course. Of course.
It is very sensitive to ask. What we know is whether or not, like, you, we know employment status, but we don't know sort of, you know,
earnings level
breakdown. Yeah. Yes, yeah, right. Yes, we don't know. However, yes, we do know earnings level in the baseline. So we know that for both men and women in the baseline. We didn't collect the earnings level in the follow-up, but we know in the baseline. And what we also know is sort of questions relating to bargaining power. Okay, so, you know, you have in the DHS, right?
Mm-hmm.
Bunch of questions relating to bargaining power, who is taking decisions and so on. So we have some of those. Right. It might be interesting to look at some of that, but we don't have too much detailed data beyond what I just told you.
Mm. Okay, I'll not take up any more of your time.
We do have some question from Shushoma.
Hi, I'm audible.
Hi, yes, you are.
Hi, Shanjari. Yeah, I joined a bit late, but I was curious to know, like, how did you look? I believe that you did a telephonic survey of these informal sector women workers, I guess, in Delhi, right?
Yeah. Okay. Well, so, women and their husbands.
As their husbands. Okay. So I was just curious, like, how did you locate the, you know, these informal sector workers? Because we do not have such database as such, right? So how did you locate it?
We went the other way. Okay. So we went the other way because as I was mentioning in the early part of the talk, I'm not sure you probably missed that this was kind of dovetailing into an existing study where we are trying to understand the constraints faced by women in participating in the labor force with a specific focus to informal sector work, and therefore we located the study in industrial clusters of Delhi. Okay, so we looked at 5 districts of Delhi which were heavy on industrial clusters, which is where we have a already high proportion of women and men engaged in informal work, right? So it was not like looking for a needle in a haystack. We started because that was the premise of the project. So therefore, we ended up with a fair proportion of women who are engaged in informal work and self-employed, to be honest. Okay?
Okay. All right. All right. Thank you. Thank you so much.
No worries.
Zakida, can you ask your question? Yes.
I think Shopneel has also raised his hand.
Shopneel is there. Okay. Yeah. Shopneel, you can go ahead. Yes.
Yes, ma'am. So the study, ma'am, as we saw in the presentation, did not get any significant difference in the employment of women pre and post pandemic. But then, since you considered an urban center like Delhi, which is like heavily industrialized, and women had access to this self-employment opportunities, do you think like the results might not be representative of other parts of the country?
Oh, like of course. Absolutely. You're absolutely right. This is not to say, because as I was mentioning, if you think about some of the other studies that also have been looked at during this particular point in time, one of those studies is actually for Delhi, all of Delhi, which is Sonal's study. So there actually they find, because they have a much wider mix of, you know, different employment profiles and probably a heavier leaning towards informal sector work, including domestic workers, they find that, you know, there is a negative shock for women as well, which is also what we know from, you know, looking around us and from anecdotal evidence. So I think as far as the women's employment results is concerned, that is probably our findings are very specific to the sample we are studying. And also the fact that these women had access to these opportunities in the baseline. So yes, I completely agree with you that it would be very hard to extrapolate the female employment results beyond the context that we are looking at.
If the students have some questions, they can ask. I think Mike, I have asked too many questions, so I can wait.
I don't think I. Joita, you want to ask anything? Your hand is raised.
No, I think Joita's hand was not lowered. Yeah, the students, do you want to ask some other questions, please? Okay.
Hello.
Please.
Thank you, ma'am, for the amazing presentation. My question is, like, is there any way that the male counterparts help the female to, like, reduce the psychological stress, or maybe the other way around as well?
It's difficult to tell in the data, right? Because all we are picking up is individual responses. However, like I was saying, for the employment results, it's possible that they, again, I mean, whenever I have spoken about these results, discussed this with, you know, my colleagues or other, you know, in other seminars, people have kind of also agreed with the idea that this was a time of extra stress within the family, right? And given the very difficult circumstances, and given that this is Delhi, and given that this is, you know, the specific set of socioeconomic status that we are observing, it's possible that there could have been, I mean, rather than mitigating each other's stress, it's possible that there could have been a cumulative effect, right? Which is probably, you know, rubbing off on spouses. But in terms of how we can capture this in the data, this would be very difficult because these were all individual responses we picked up. I don't know. I mean, we could probably look at by how long you've been married and things like that. But those would be a little bit, I would say, superficial in terms of getting at the specific aspect. So I'm not sure whether we can really say much about that. But it's a good question. It's just that we don't have an answer.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
And on similar lines, right? So there were some speculations, right, that intimate partner violence might go up because they are going to be staying together, and that might explain why women are, you know, getting more stressed with the husband staying home.
Absolutely. I think you raise a very important point, Nikita. I think because there's been quite a lot of focus on IPV, right, on domestic violence. In fact, the bunch of studies now also in the context of India, looking at how sort of, you know, using the variation in containment and looking at what implications that might have in terms of people calling helplines, right? So you're absolutely right. This is a very tense environment, probably at home. What I will say is that given that we didn't ask questions about domestic violence, it would probably, we can't speculate about that, but from other literature and other studies, what we are finding is that this could definitely be another channel of, you know, aggravation of mental stress, especially with unemployment husbands at home who are also extremely upset at, you know, having lost their work. So I would say all of this is what I'm trying to sort of club under the umbrella of sort of, you know, internalized gender norms or attitudes, but sort of, you know, using the terms a bit loosely, right? But these are specific sort of, you know, mechanisms which would kind of explain the story that we are trying to build here.
Shanchari, I have one question to you. This is Joita.
Yeah. Go on, Joita.
So I have the question related to the social networks. Okay. So my question is that do the friends or the neighbors of those women of your study, do they work in the same informal industry, this shoe leather thing?
Well, remember, it's not only shoe leather. Okay, I just give you one example. But yeah,
okay.
Okay. We could check that. But what we do find is when they are reporting to us friends, you know, who are home-based and friends who are in the workplace, they are typically separate. So there's not a lot of overlap, but I should check that. There's not a lot of overlap.
No, why I am asking is this, if the friends of these women, I mean, who are the respondent of your survey, if they belong to the same workplace or if they something like this, then when they talk, they will always talk about their work condition, whether they've lost their jobs, whether there is any possibility to find a job or not, and all these things. So I think this will adversely affect their stress. I mean, they will become more stressful because if their close circle always talk regarding this.
Yes, you're absolutely right. So, for instance, I think what you're saying is a part of the story of overall contagion. So you're pointing to the fact that this might be contagion relating to work conditions, that everybody's lost everybody themselves, their husbands have lost their jobs, right?
Most
of the husbands have lost their jobs. So the point is, I think this would be a subset of the set of issues that might be setting off the overall contagion. You're absolutely right. if I remember correctly from the baseline, there was not a lot of overlap between their own friends, I mean, between the friends that are close by and the friends who are work-based friends, right? So it's less likely that they would classify as somebody who's living next door as also somebody whom they work with. Okay, so these would be two separate sets of people. However, I want to go back and check whether there is substantial overlap and if there is enough variation for us to look at that. But you're absolutely right. This would form one of the sort of pathways as to how the stress increases, right?
Yes. But within the social group.
Exactly. But the point I'm trying to make is that it could be bigger than that as well. It could be broader than that. I mean, that is obviously going to be a part of the story, but it could be just broader than like what Prithviraj was saying, right? It could just be kids, or it could just be where is my ration going to come from, or where did you get access to those, you know, food transfers, or what is your husband doing, and so on. So I think it would be broader, but all of this would fall under what we are sort of, again, using as an umbrella term, the contagion effect.
Yes, yes. Thank you.
Upanita has raised her hand again.
Hello, ma'am. I have one more question.
Hi.
Hello, ma'am. Like through the data that you have collected, like it shows that women have suffer from a more contagion effect than men. But why is it so? Like, don't the men have the same kind of problems? Like, it's also their children, their ration, their wives, their livelihood. And since mostly it's always thought that the men are the breadwinner of the family, but like when they're circulating this stuff in their social networks, like don't the men whom they actually interact with have the same kind of problems? And why is it that only the women have a worse effect in terms of stress if we take the contagion effect into consideration?
You're absolutely right. And that's a very valid question, something I don't think we are able to get at using this current set of study. Because, you know, for example, you know, for instance, it could just be that given that women are often more in charge of, you know, making the household decisions, and this is speculative. We don't have the data to actually specifically look at that, at least in this version of the paper. But given that women are more in charge of making the household decisions of, you know, spending or, you know, where is food going to come from and so on and so forth, whereas men might be more specifically concerned about, you know, their labor market outcomes, but then they are seeing that all their friends are in the same, you know, space, okay? So it's just everybody is being affected by that. Whereas the day-to-day, the nitty-gritties of actual household management, right, is oftentimes borne by the women, and therefore they might be stressing each other out more along those dimensions, kind of going back to the earlier question about whose responsibility is what, right? But this is entirely speculative, okay? So this is something that we are trying to sort of, you know, argue is could be a mechanism to explain this. But at the end of the day, as far as this version of the paper is concerned, we really don't know. And that is what I ended the talk on, to say that in future work, what we really want to look at is to understand why would men's and women's networks behave differently in crisis, right? And this could be one mechanism in terms of sort of the roles that people are playing. And also possibly linking a little bit back to gender attitudes and gender norms. But that's where it is currently. It's kind of at the hand-waving speculative level.
We have Shopnil here. Shopnil, can you ask a question?
Yes, ma'am. So in the study, you basically considered employment, financial and health conditions as factors determining the mental health of the respondent. But do you think since the pandemic affected the country, like all parts of the country, so like there is a higher, as you mentioned, these were migrant, the population was a migrant population and they had like family members back in their native places. And so there was an increased demand for remittances, or they had to send greater amount of money back to their native places. So that might affect the mental stress or increase the mental stress of the respondents.
Yes, and I would argue for these people, then this would be captured by the financial stress
channel, right? So the financial stress aspect, not just about financial needs of their immediate family, but also family back home. So I would club that under the sort of the financial worries question, which we are picking up.
Okay, may I ask some questions, please?
Sure, go ahead.
Well, firstly, I mean, I would like to congratulate you for a wonderful work. Great work, very interesting. I mean, COVID has posed a lot of problems for us field workers. And you have overcome them and provided very useful real-time information. I mean, there are obviously limitations, but I mean, COVID, given the new characteristics of COVID, we have to face up. That there will be some problems. Anyway, I want to ask some clarifications, please. What was the time of your survey?
So you mean the post-COVID?
Second.
Or second, huh? Yeah. So that was April to May. So I think 3rd April is when we started, and we finished about end of May, probably early June.
Okay. Well, actually, there are two reasons why I'm asking. One is that in the lockdown was announced in March, and so you have started the field work just after 1 week.
Yes.
Everything is uncertain, but in May, lockdowns are gradually being, I think, withdrawn, opening up. So the situation is same. How was the time effect of this?
Yeah.
I mean, you have the dates of survey.
We do. So in this version of the paper, we kind of sort of treat the entire survey as kind of, you know, one timeline. But you would agree that the situation was not the same between, the early part of the lockdown and the later part of the lockdown, so actually what we do find in an earlier version that we sort of wrote down, we looked at this, you know, phase one and phase two. Phase one being sort of, you know, early April to about the first, around the time when the first unlocking started, right? And then phase two was basically the next part when things were slowly opening up and so on. And as far as we didn't find that the employment implications diminished. Okay, so we have all these results separately in the IGC report that we wrote. We didn't find the employment negative implications diminished. What we actually found was some of the mental stress results actually went up, not always significantly across all dimensions, but some of them became a little more stringent in terms of their intensity. But for the purpose of this paper, we kind of moved away from doing that within sort of, you know, within the survey phase-wise analysis to kind of looking at it at a whole.
Yeah, and just two comments. I mean, it's not, I mean, given the framework of your survey, it's not possible to take this, but I mean, I think most of the studies have found that women have experienced or exhibit greater stress. But over time, this stress does seem to be coming down. I mean, it would be interesting, if possible, to have a follow-up survey, look at it.
Right. So we do actually. In fact, I was telling you, right, that we are trying to sort of extend this analysis to, for instance, look at the role of networks more carefully. So what we do have is two further rounds of data that we collected. One is end of 2020. So this was kind of the lull period after the first wave and before the second. And then we had another follow-up around the time of the second wave, which is when sort of, you know, the lockdowns were much more localized. So we had all the micro-containment strategies rather than the national lockdown. So what we are trying to do is to look at this time variation, right? So we have one survey, which is the first phone survey in the during the early part of the national stringent lockdown. Then we had another post-pandemic survey, which was during the time when things were getting a little bit better, and then the final one at the time of the second lockdown or micro-containment period, right? So what we are trying to understand is sort of the dynamic implications of what happens over time as we see the pandemic unfold. And very preliminary results, obviously, please don't quote me on this, but we've looked at very
preliminary results, it does seem the stress, even if it is coming down, it is still significant, sort of, you know, significantly high. So we do continue to find the fact that as and when people have gone into lockdown and come out of it, the mental stress levels have been quite high. We want to dig deeper into sort of looking at the gender differentials and also the dynamic pattern that we are observing with the ups and the downs. Hopefully there'll be sort of, you know, more that we can do to understand not just that, but also what networks can do in the process of mediating this stress. So yeah, we will hopefully have some answers to your questions, Ankit, going forward. But right now it's very preliminary.
Okay, then just last two questions, please.
Go ahead, yeah.
First question, will you please present those results again in presidency?
Of course.
We would love to hear them.
I would love to.
We'll contact you later then. The second question, more seriously. You have shown that there's a very high level of mental stress, right? 60%, 70%.
Mm-hmm.
How serious is this, given the fact that, see, I mean, when a pandemic starts, there will be a stress, but this need not lead to something which is a chronic or level of mental health which requires treatment. This is something which is going to, people are going to adjust and go away.
Yes.
So how serious do you think is the problem, level of mental health?
Right, and how persistent would that be, right? So I think, again, we will have to see. I think the best way to answer that question would be once the pandemic has receded to get some more funding to go back and, you know, interview the same people. But more seriously, I think we will probably get some sense of the dynamic nature of what happens to mental stress, especially for the second round, right? Which is when things were almost, you know, normal, and we had this euphoric sense that, you know, India has beat COVID and people were out and about. So trying to sort of really get a sense of how those periods had an impact on people's mental stress, which can give us a peek as to how permanent or how chronic it would be. And while there is a lot of, I think, discussion around how the pandemic has shifted our mental spaces, our mental well-beings, in a good way, in the sense that there is now more spotlight on these challenges, right, that people have been facing probably, you know, in an endemic way even before, definitely before. But now the spotlight is there. So that's a good thing that people are talking about it. But how much of this will continue to have a real impact on people's day-to-day lives, I think that remains to be seen. It's probably something that this particular study is not equipped to answer. But as we move on in terms of looking at the further rounds of data, we'll probably have a better sense. And then, who knows, maybe gather some further funding to look at really post-pandemic effects.
Great. So that will be the third seminar in precedence.
Thank you. Then you will get bored and say, okay, we don't want to see Sanchari's face anymore.
Never with an ex-presidency. You're always welcome.
Thank you very much. You're very kind.
Yeah, I think Mosh.
Thank you, Shanchari. I think Mosh Umidi will like to say some few words. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It was a wonderful presentation, and it's really a topic, you know, which we are all suffering from. It's not, you know, something academic, something outside the periphery. So it's just a real life story. Thank you very much, and as Zaki said, please go on, and we will wait for your results. You know, so also we faced some problems during the IGC projects related to the COVID, etc. So we understand. Yes, if you go on checking all the periods, you know, so you will get the wonderful dynamics, and you know, what will be the, you know, how we will be able to address the pandemic, you know. So it will not just add to the current literature, but it will, you know, show the pathway in future.
Yes, hopefully. And there is a lot of interesting work that many people are doing, yourselves included, which really we commend everybody to really contribute to our understanding. It is such an unprecedented shock, right? It was a health shock, then it became an economic shock because of the lockdown. Yes. Then it precipitated into a bigger health shock in the second wave. So it's the pandemic itself is unfolding in its own way. So I think, all of this work is really contributing to our understanding.
Okay, thank you, Shantanu.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me, and all the questions and all the feedback, please read the paper. It's out online, it's on my website, and if you have further feedback, further questions and comments for us, please write to me. I would love to hear from all of you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Bye then.
Thank you. Take
thank
care.
You so bye. Much, Shantanu. Thank you.
Thank bye. You, Shantanu. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mom.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Okay, then I'm closing the meeting.
Yes, thank you, everybody. Zakir, would you please
stop?